Summer in Connecticut, man. I had planned to shoot all this outside in the field and you'd see me like shooting birds and stuff, but it's been raining like all week. So I've been out shooting, but there was no way we were gonna film anything. So I am just gonna wrap up my review of the 600 millimeter super zooms for wildlife here in the studio. All this with the body will get you in under $3,000. Some of it a little bit less than $2,000. We have the Nikon 200 to 500. We have the Tamron 150 to 600 G2, the Sigma 150 to 600 Sport, and the Sony 200 to 600 brand new. And that's why we did this, because people were asking about it. Does it hang? Should you use one of the third-party lenses instead? First, let me say thanks to Lens Rentals for loaning us this gear. We rented it from Lens Rentals. If you want to rent stuff, head to stp.io/rent. You can use the coupon code NORTHRUP15 for 15% off. It's a great way to try stuff out for yourself. Let's get right into it. Let's first talk about the handling. This is a really big deal for people shooting wildlife, because often you have to hike out quite a bit. Sometimes if you're shooting flying birds, you have no choice but to hand hold these things, and you're holding them up, and the longer you can hand hold it, the better shots that you're going to get. There was a big difference between the lenses generally. First of all, this is kind of a big deal, but all the lenses change length when you zoom except for the Sony. So let me demonstrate this. Oh my God, this lens is heavy. As I zoom this from 150 to 600, you can see it gets substantially longer. And first that makes it heavier, because now this fairly heavy hood is suspended way out at a farther distance, and that makes it harder to hand hold. But also, let's zoom it back. As I'm hiking, as I'm walking from one spot to another, you can see it just extends by itself, and you can fix that. There's a little locking mechanism, and you just need to lock that, and then it won't do it. But that means you're constantly managing that switch, and I always forget, and then it's hanging and banging around on stuff. So I prefer that the Sony here, when I zoom it, it doesn't grow. It just stays exactly the same size. That means it balances better, especially on a tripod. That's a good thing. So that's a win for the Sony. Another big difference for Sony is the Sony cameras are mirrorless, while the Nikon and Canon cameras are DSLRs. So they have optical viewfinders on the DSLRs, the Canon and Nikon cameras, and an electronic viewfinder on the Sony cameras. We found this to be a pretty big difference in the real world. The electronic viewfinder is not as fun. Like, you can see the animals, you can get stuff in focus, but the viewfinders are like 3 megapixels, but you're focused on a very small part of the frame, typically, if you're looking at a small bird. And it doesn't look good. It starts to look really pixelated. The optical viewfinder has more of like a 3D feel to it. Everything seems sharper, and you know, part of shooting wildlife is actually enjoying being close to nature. And I get a better experience with the DSLRs. It doesn't change my results, but I did get a better experience. I also want to address the lag on the electronic viewfinders. Now, previously I complained about the lag on the Sony A9 when I was shooting continuously for multiple seconds at a time. The lag would grow to be greater than a tenth of a second, and that was enough that it made it hard for me to track birds that were moving side to side. They would simply fly out of the frame because I was looking at pictures a couple of frames in the past and made it impossible for me to keep up with them. I have changed my shooting behavior a little bit with the A9, where I will shoot and then release and shoot and release, and when I release it, it allows the lag to drop and allows me to keep up with the bird. So that's mostly solved, but it's still not ideal. How the bodies handle is a big difference between these. The Sony bodies are designed to be very small and compact, and that does not work well with these huge bodies. So you can get the job done, certainly, but I will probably end up just always using a vertical grip when I am shooting with these big lenses. The Nikon bodies are designed to be big and bulky. They feel great in the hands. Another handling difference is with the Sony A6400 and the A9 that we tested. They have Sony's new real-time tracking autofocus, which allowed me to never have to touch the thumbstick or adjust the focusing point. I just always use the center focusing point with the real-time tracking and focus and recompose, and it worked great. So with the Nikon cameras, I'm still kind of moving the thumbstick around and manually selecting an autofocus point. So there are pluses and minuses. They both worked. I don't know which I really preferred, but they both got the job done. Let's talk about the stabilization in the lenses. All of these lenses are image stabilized, and that can be really important. I know some of you think, oh, you're always shooting at 1/2000th of a second if you're shooting wildlife, but that's not true. This particular picture here was taken at an equivalent of 1260 millimeters and handheld at 1/160th of a second, and I was able to get sharp results. And in fact, I've shot at similar focal length all the way down to 1/25th of a second. If you're in dark woods and an animal is being still, you can do that. and the stabilization makes that possible. There was a big difference in how these lenses handle stabilization, though, and I found this out when I did my tripod test. The Sony and Nikon native lenses automatically adapted to the tripod. The Tamron and Sigma lenses, you have to remember to turn off stabilization if you put it on a tripod or a monopod, or the stabilization will actually ruin your sharpness. Like, the stabilization keeps moving the lens elements, even when it's on a tripod, they do not detect that. And that's gonna be a problem at some point. If you ever use a tripod and you think you might forget to flip that little switch, or forget to switch it back on when you go to hand hold it again, if you're not the type who's gonna 100% always remember to flip that switch, then it will ruin the sharpness of some of your shots. I know me, I will at some point forget to flip that switch because I get so involved in the shooting process. So I really appreciate that the native lenses handle that for me automatically. And for me alone, that might be a deal breaker for the third party lenses. Autofocus was another problem that we ran into with the third party lenses. The Tamron and Sigma lenses simply did not have the focusing accuracy of the native lenses. And I think there are a few reasons for this. Probably primarily Tamron and Sigma have to kind of reverse engineer the communications protocols to the body. And that's not going to be quite as perfect as the manufacturer who understands everything perfectly. Another potential problem with it is that the Nikon and Canon DSLR bodies and the Sony bodies are tested with those lenses and they don't test third-party lenses. So you don't have perfect compatibility. What it means is I got in-focus shots with all the lenses. People will get in-focus shots, but I got higher percentages, more consistent focusing, and faster autofocus with the native lenses. And that is a big deal with wildlife, something that you can't quantify necessarily. People ask about adapting the Canon versions of the Tamron and Sigma lenses to the Sony bodies with the Sigma MC11 adapter, and we don't find the autofocus to be very good. Again, it will work. You can produce good results. Up until now, you've had to do that. But now that Sony makes a zoom lens, we definitely recommend that over trying to adapt it with the mediocre autofocus that you get. On the Sony A9 and the A6400, they have the real-time autofocus, and that produced close to 100% perfect sharp results. It's an amazing system. Right now, for those of you asking, the A7R III and the A7 III do not have that. They have a more primitive autofocus system, which underperformed. Now, we were able to get sharp results with those cameras also, but it is not as fast, it is not as consistent, it is not as good of an experience. For those of you who need the extra reach of a higher megapixel camera, I'd actually recommend picking up the Sony A6400 because it has an APS-C sensor with 24 megapixels crammed into it. So you basically get the pixel density of an A7R Mark III at a lower price point. I'm gonna take a quick second to plug my stuff. We still have a Father's Day sale going on, even though we should probably stop it, but it's 30% off, northrup.photo. You can use the coupon code DAD30. That includes everything from our cool t-shirts to stunning digital photography, the number one photography book in the world, books that will teach you how to use Lightroom and Photoshop, video books with video, but also our presets that with a few clicks will let you do massive changes like bringing a sky back and recovering shadows, making your pictures and landscapes and portraits just look amazing. And of course, everything comes with a money-back guarantee. So head on over to northrup.photo and get 30% off. That's not something we do often. Let's talk about the sharpness. I know people think that this is the most important thing, but the reason I put this after handling and autofocus is I don't think sharpness is as important as those things. But let's pop into Lightroom where I did controlled studio tests. First, let's compare the Tamron and Sigma lenses. This is a Sigma sport lens, not the contemporary. This is the Tamron on the left, and you can see it's substantially less sharp than the Sigma. The Sigma is also more expensive. To really see us, let's go into 4:1 because I know some people are looking at smaller screens, not something we normally do with wildlife, but here you can really see how much more detail the Sigma is giving you. This is going to translate into extra croppability, which is really common in wildlife photography. Almost all wildlife photography is cropped. It is ideal to get closer. With the Tamron at 600 millimeters, if you get close enough and fill the frame, you're gonna get a super sharp, sellable result. But there are many times when you won't be able to and you will have to crop. And in those times, something like a Sigma 600 millimeter is going to do a better job for you. So knowing that the Tamron is the least sharp of those, let's compare the Sigma 600 millimeter to the Nikon 200-500. This is the Nikon on the left. And I know it seems unfair that the Nikon is only a 500 millimeter. And I think a lot of people dismiss it because it doesn't go to 600 millimeters. But the fact of the matter is you can be as sharp and just crop a little bit and still get good results. So zooming into 4:1, we can see even though it's not as long, it's almost the same amount of sharpness. We do see a little bit more detail out of the Sigma, and whether or not that extra detail is worth the extra cost and autofocus and image stabilization problems is something that I'll leave up to you. Finally, let's compare the benchmark Sigma against the Sony 200 to 600. Here we see virtually identical results, which is good news for the Sony because the Sigma itself is very, very sharp. If we start to move out towards the edges of the frame, it changes a little bit. Here we see the Sony actually looks quite a bit better, and we start to see some chromatic aberration from the Sigma that is not present in the Sony. To officially rank them, last place is Tamron. It can be sharp enough for a lot of people, but it's not as sharp as the other lenses, and your crop ability is going to be limited. Number three is the Nikon 200 to 500, but really, the differences are so insignificant in a laboratory with a heavy tripod and a delayed shutter that in the real world, when you're dealing with moving animals and atmospheric conditions, you probably will never see a difference, and things like autofocus and handling are going to make a bigger difference. Number two is the Sigma, which had image quality almost as good as the Sony, but it got a little bit worse at the edges, which actually aren't all that important. And Sony here comes in with the best image quality at 600 millimeters. Let's talk about how these lenses handle teleconverters. A lot of you want to know if you can slap a 1.4 or 2x teleconverter on them. I do not recommend that with any of these. With the Nikon cameras, you can put a teleconverter on, but even with the D500, great autofocus system, the autofocus really suffers a lot, and that detracts a lot from the images that you're going to produce. With the A9 and the A6400, both the 1.4 and 2x teleconverters on the 200 to 600 here worked awesome. You hardly noticed it. They still got amazing autofocus performance, but I'm still not recommending it. If you want to use the A7 III or the A7 R3 or any other Sony camera with a teleconverter, they perform poorly. The teleconverter immediately drops the autofocus performance noticeably. It begins to hunt weirdly. It's almost like using a third-party adapted lens. Let's go into Lightroom, and I want to show you what happens when you put a teleconverter, even on the very best lens here. First, let's compare the camera with a 2x teleconverter versus without a teleconverter at all. So we're zooming way in here to really see the detail on it. I'm just gonna zoom the one without the teleconverter in farther. And as you look at these, this is without the teleconverter, 600 millimeters. This is with at 1200 millimeters. Digitally zoomed produces better results than putting on the teleconverter. Let's compare it with and without the 1.4 teleconverter. Again, the image is just sharper and more contrasty without the teleconverter. So I shot a lot with the teleconverters on the Sony. They performed well. But now that I look at it in the lab, I wish I had just shot without the teleconverter and cropped in post. So there, I saved you a few bucks on buying a teleconverter. Contrast is something almost nobody measures. If you shoot into backlit conditions, like an overcast sky with a flying bird, contrast will cause light to bounce around inside the lens and overall reduce the sharpness of it. To simulate this, I put a strobe behind our mannequin and shot each of the lenses into it at 600 millimeters to see how they handled that sort of direct light. Just looking at these thumbnails should tell you everything you need to know. This is the Sigma. It actually did the worst. You can see this crazy amount of flaring that popped up. This is the Tamron, and it actually did really, really well, especially for a lens that wasn't that sharp. You can see the Nikon here didn't handle the flaring very well at all. Note that I shut the Nikon down to 6.3 for all these tests to match the aperture. If I open it up to f5.6, it actually gets a little bit worse, but I wanted to be fair and shoot at the same aperture. And the Sony here handled the flaring really pretty well too, and looks really good. So our rankings for the contrast, last place went to Sigma, third place went to the Nikon, and first place was tied between the Sony and Tamron. If you are shooting in backlit conditions, that's something to really consider. Our overall recommendations for the super zooms, first I want to say, if you have a Canon body, you can use the Sigma or the Tamron, but Canon does not have a native 600 millimeter super zoom or anything similar to that. So we still recommend at this price point picking up the old 400 millimeter f5.6 prime. It outperforms the Tamron and the Sigma at 600 millimeters, digitally cropping down. It is a great lens. It's just not image stabilized. If you have shaky hands, if you want to really shoot with low shutter speeds and don't want to use any kind of support, then I would recommend the Sigma instead, but be prepared to suffer with those image stabilization and autofocus problems. This you can get used, which I would highly recommend, for under $2,000. Buy it used because these are both durable pieces of equipment and they're readily available and much cheaper than new. So I need to assign a first and second place, but it's really hard because the equipment is so incredibly different. First of all, I'm eliminating the Tamron and Sigma from the running just because of the various issues that we found. They're excellent. You can produce good results, but I'm not going to recommend them. So I'm between the D500 with a Nikon 200 to 500 and the Sony A6400 with the Sony 200 to 600. And I'm going to rank the Sony in second, but it's not going to be that clear cut for everybody. First of all, if you are a Sony user, the 200 to 600 is excellent. It produces amazing results. It all works really, really well. It comes in at a high price at $2,900. The Nikon setup is cheaper. This is with the A6400, which is a really small body and handling is a problem. It also has only a single card slot, a really small battery, even though battery life is quite a bit better than it has been in the past. The EVF, I don't consider it optimal, but it does produce great results. The autofocus, I actually like it better than the D500, and the images, they're great. It has a higher megapixel count at 24 megapixels. If you ever plan to shoot any video, that's an amazing rig for shooting wildlife video because you can use the viewfinder, you can shoot in 4K, you can get a little extra crop, and the results will be absolutely stunning, provided you have a big, heavy tripod. Again, by a very narrow margin, I'm assigning the winner to the D500 with the 200 to 500. This is the rig we've been recommending for years and shooting with for years. Used, you can pick it up for about $2,000. It is way louder than the A6400, and it's a little bit heavier, but it feels good in my hands. I love the optical viewfinder. The autofocus system works absolutely fantastically, and it's just a great, well-proven rig. It's weatherproof, so if it starts to rain, which it does a lot, it'll be okay. It can also write to two card slots, so you won't have a day out shooting where you got the best picture of your life ruined because a card fails. These are real life concerns, and the Nikon is just kind of reliable and does it. But either way, either one you pick, you're going to be happy. I hope this has helped. Be sure to subscribe because we have a couple more wildlife reviews coming up in the next week. We're doing a review of the Sony 600 F4 against the Nikon in depth. And we also have a wildlife tutorial coming out. Hit that notification bell too. And as a reminder, you can go to northrup.photo and take advantage of our Father's Day sale with the coupon DAD30, 30% off any of our stuff. If you want to rent some stuff, head over to Lens Rentals at sdp.io/rent and use the coupon code Northrup15. That's a great way to try this out and see how it actually works for you because everybody's different. And a shout out to our partner KEH, where you can buy some of this stuff used or get rid of your old gear if you're deciding to switch between systems. They also fix stuff for you. Thank you, KEH. Bye. Oh, if you have follow-up questions, write it down below. I'd also love to hear your own experiences with good or bad with any of this gear. Thanks.